Yo!
What's up? I'm Adam.
And I'm Simon.
And Simon is joining us to take us on an adventure with streaming data and Microsoft Fabric. Simon, thank you for joining us. Before we get into all of it, just tell the folks who you are and what you do.
My name's Simon Nuss, and I work at Microsoft on the customer advisory, or the CAT team, as a principal program manager. So I'm really, in this role, the window into the product group. I work with customers all over the world, making sure that feedback is given to the appropriate product group managers to make Fabric a better product for everybody. And outside of work, I'm the moderator of the Power BI subreddit, wearing my shirt today, and also of the Microsoft Fabric subreddit as well.
And we'll have links down in the description below for the subreddits, so definitely participate in that. There's a lot of great discussions going on. All right, so my understanding here is that we're going to go on this little adventure with streaming data. So what are we going to be looking at?
Today, we are going to look at RTI, or real-time intelligence, but with a little bit of a twist. So my daughter, she's 6 years old, and she loves Minecraft. I also play Minecraft as well with her. And so I thought to myself, look, how could I combine my love and my daughter's love for Minecraft with what I do for a living, which is Microsoft Fabric? So today I'm going to show real-time streaming using Minecraft.
Oh, all right. Simon, enough of all this talking. You know, we like to do it here on Guy in a Cube. Let's do what? Let's head over to your machine. Before you get into it, I'm like, I don't know. Are we doing like a Twitch stream, or like, what are we doing? This is awesome. I love video games. So.
A little bit of Twitch streaming and a little bit of analytics fun as well.
Yes. And I do appreciate in the bottom there where it says slash fabric.
So that's an interesting fact. So the modding framework in Minecraft that I use is actually called Fabric. So I'm using Minecraft Fabric, the modding framework, to make a mod to send data to Microsoft Fabric. And Minecraft is actually owned by Microsoft as well.
So a little bit of inception. I love it. All right, let's go.
All right, so let's take a look. So I'm going to look into my Minecraft world. So here we have a farm. We have four guys in a cube here. And in each cube, we have a little farmer. And you'll note that in each farm, we have a crop, a different type of crop. So here we have some beets. Over here, we have some wheat. Over here, we have some, what's this? We have some potatoes on the ground, and finally some carrots. And so what's happening here is that each of these farmers throughout the day, they're going to pick up the crops that are fully grown, plant a new seed, and rinse and repeat. And I would love to capture that. And so what I've done here is I've created a little fabric block in Minecraft. Oh. So I'm going to go place a couple more of these blocks over here. There we go. And let's have a look. So what happens when I right click one of these blocks? Let's see what it's asking me for. So it's an event relay configuration, and it's asking me for a block name. And in this case, we are looking at potatoes. So I'm going to right-click this block and say potato. And it's asking me for an event detection radius. So it's saying, look, at this block's location, what events do you want to capture around that? So I'm going to say within a 5 bounding block radius, I want to capture those farming events. And lastly, it's asking for an event hub connection string. This is a feature that we have in RTI event streams. So with that said, let's have a look. Let's flip over to RTI event streams and get that connection string. So here I have my web browser, and I've already loaded event streams. And what I have in event streams, quite simply, is a custom endpoint, which is effectively a location that data can be sent to. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down the bottom here, grab my primary connection string, and copy that key to my clipboard. So now I can go back to Minecraft and paste that in here. And so I'm going to do the same for the other ones. Carrots, 5 block radius, paste in the same connection string. Beets, 5, paste that in. And lastly, all the way to wheat, 5, and paste that in. So I'll pause the game for a moment. When I unpause, what's effectively going to happen is as those crops grow through those stages, those events are going to be streamed through each of those blocks to that event hub endpoint, or that event stream custom endpoint here on my screen. And I've actually made a little Power BI report up the back here that should render some of these results. And as we can see, we've already started seeing some events come through. So with that said, guys, let's go back to the game. And I am going to try make the game go a little bit faster. There we go. Let's see if we can fit both on the screen here. So on the right, we see those farmers running around super, super quick. They're picking up those crops, planting new seeds. And on the left, we're seeing a bit of a race. I'm effectively trying to determine who can plant the most crops. And so on the left there, we see that currently carrots is winning. And as those events are getting streamed through from that one block, it's going through event streams, it's going through event house, which I'll talk about in a moment. And it's going all the way through to this Power BI direct query report that I have in the background. And so Adam, question for you, who do you think is going to win? Is it going to be beetroots? Is it going to be wheat, potatoes, or carrots?
So we got Martha, we got Patrick, we got me, and we've got Simon. So I'm going to go with Martha. She's going to win.
There we go. I'm pretty sure Martha's mom picking up the carrots here, so she's definitely winning. We see beetroots not doing too well there at the end.
Nice.
So we have these blocks in Minecraft streaming that data through to a Power BI direct query report. And as you can see, it is snappy, it is quick. Every second, that data is flowing through. So what I'd like to highlight here is that this demo is really quite interesting. because what we actually see is a replication or a reflection of real life. Mm-hmm. Imagine if you had like a manufacturing plant or an agricultural farm or a transit system. You have sensors set up. Those sensors, they detect events and those stream through to Microsoft Fabric. That's exactly what I've replicated here.
Nice.
And so each of these blocks has inside of it, in the game itself, something called an event hub producer. And an event hub producer is a SDK provided by Microsoft that any language practically can use. It supports C Sharp, Python, and in my case, I'm using the Java version of it. And I'll give you a little demo of how easy it was for me to stream data from Minecraft using this event hub producer. I'm going to pause the game for a moment and I'm just going to tab to my IDE. So this is a piece of code here. As I mentioned, it's Java. I get it, it's code heavy, but to use an event hub producer, you really need to write some code that are close to those IoT devices on your manufacturing plant, for example. But very simply, we've got about 20 lines of code here. But at the end of the day, all that's happening is Minecraft is sending through a JSON object to my code. And then my code is essentially taking that JSON object and that gets forwarded to Fabric. And this is really quite simple. In fact, it's even easier in other languages as well. I didn't know Java very well before I started creating this. And so to create this Minecraft mod, I had to learn Java, and ChatGPT was the product that helped me do that. And so it took me about a week or two to create this whole block this in Minecraft that streams data through to Fabric. There's obviously more code to it than what you see on the screen here, but this is just the code that publishes the event. Yep. And this could be used in any product, any IoT device that you have out there. So that's that. And we've got this data streaming through from Minecraft, ultimately into that direct query Power BI report. Let's go back to the beginning and have a look and see how that's all linked together. So here I have my workspace for everything in this demo. And so very clearly we get data through that event stream, which I'll flip to in a moment. We then prepare data using the Event House product and a KQL database within that Event House. And lastly, we visualize that data in that Power BI report. So let's dive into get data and see, you know, what is an event stream and how easy was that to set up. And I've got that loaded here in the background, as you saw before. And very simply, guys, three boxes. On the left here, this custom endpoint. That effectively gives that connection string that I pasted into Minecraft. And then that then goes to a destination of my KQL database in my event house. There's not a lot to this product, which is the best part about it. It's so easy to set up real-time streaming using an event stream. So as data comes in, you can set up multiple destinations. For example, to a lake house, but in my case, just to a KQL database. Let's head over to that KQL database and see how I process that data, getting it ready for that Power BI report. Because one thing I do want to highlight here is that the data that's being sent, as you saw before, is JSON. I can't just use JSON in a Power BI report. I need to clean it. So let's have a look at those steps. And so what I'll do is I'll click through to my event house. And one event house has multiple databases. In my simple example, I just have one Minecraft database. So let's click through to that. And there's quite a lot of stuff on the screen here, guys. But the high level is I take that JSON data that's loaded from event streams into my bronze table here on the left. And then that data in real time is transformed from bronze into silver, and then silver into my farming gold table that my Power BI report then picks up. And so let's unpack that a little bit. So there's a neat new feature here in Event House called the entity diagram. So I'm just going to click on that. And this really illustrates what's happening behind the scenes as my data goes through this real-time medallion architecture. So as I said, guys, Event Streams flows my raw JSON data into bronze, and I have something called a table update policy. And in KQL, what that means is that kind of like a trigger in a sense, which basically says anytime data flows into bronze, my policy is going to detect that data, apply this transformation, and load the results into the next table, which is silver. And then the same thing happens again. As data in real time flows into silver, my policy triggers or detects that, applies this transformation, then loads the results of that transformation into my final table. You have a real-time streaming medallion architecture.
I'm sure there's a little bit of latency really there, but it's not bad.
Considering we're going through bronze, silver, and gold, we're transforming, you know, a blob of JSON effectively into a structured table, and then we're doing all these calculations that I can show you in a moment, it's quick.
And the data is coming from your machine in your house all the way through the internet into Fabric.
You got it. You got it. And so I'd like to show you maybe some of the code behind this as well. And in KQL, we call that a query set. So I'm going to click on my query set, and I've got two sets of code here. One is just my utility code, pretty straightforward stuff. I'm not going to spend too much time on that, but I do have this medallion code here, and it shows or illustrates the code behind some of those boxes that you saw on the previous screen. And so realistically, as data flows from bronze into silver, to set that up, we really do three things. First, we create the silver table. The second step is we define a transformation, and that transformation has to match the schema of the silver table. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, we have that table update policy that brings the transformation and the trigger all together. And so if I scroll down a little bit here, this is just creating a table called silver, which has a column named this. And so in this case here, my X and Y, they're decimals. So I've got set up as a type real, and that's for my silver table there. If I scroll down a little bit, we're creating that function. And so this is the KQL language for those of you who haven't seen it. And I'm just going to click run to show you how it works. So I'm running a query on the bronze table and I'm projecting out these columns. For example, I'm taking the JSON from my bronze table and I'm converting that or casting that to a real. And that's going to be in a column called relay underscore event relay position.
We have that piece of the JSON, right? And we're saying, okay, this property within the JSON, this is the data that's going into this field. So we're just mapping it effectively.
Exactly. And you know, different languages handle JSON differently. What I really appreciate about KQL is the simplicity of it. JSON is a very nested structure. And so to navigate those nests, it's really just adding dots. Very simple, very elegant. And that basically takes my JSON data in my bronze table and gives it a schema that we see down the bottom here. And then the last step that we need to do, we need to bring it all together with that table update policy that we see here. It says, anytime data changes on the bronze table, take that data, run it through that transformation that we saw above, and then load the results to silver. And as soon as you click run on that, you've just linked those two tables to be streaming in real time. Going from silver to gold, it's the same three motions. Yep. We create the gold table, we define the transformation, we define that policy.
So just rinse and repeat, and then make sure everything's updated accordingly.
Exactly. Yep. So that's KQL, a real-time streaming database. You can do real-time data engineering between tables. You don't need to worry about scheduling. It just works out of the box. And this can scale to billions of rows of data very easily.
That's a lot of farmers in Minecraft.
I'd love one day to be able to just put down thousands of blocks in this Minecraft world, right? And then send them all to Fabric. And so here we go. I'll hide this in the background so we can see the full report. But as you can see, we had those farmers mining all those events.
Yeah, and then you
then paused. I paused the game for the last few minutes. If I give you that top-down view in the game, you actually get that top-down view.
Oh, look at that.
Power BI.
Oh, that's cool.
Show you where those... Exactly. And what's interesting is as I give this demo, I don't know why, but sometimes the farmers mix up the crops and I'll see pink blocks in the orange section and it's a mess. So this is actually really quite functional, that view.
We got a good one this time.
The last thing I'd love to show you is something called a real-time dashboard.
Not to be confused with a Power BI report or a Power BI dashboard. This is a real-time dashboard inside of real-time intelligence.
So a fundamentally different technology. Yes. Power BI, powered by that tabular DAX engine we all love. This is a product of the KQL engine, effectively, in a sense. Yeah, as you see, I've created effectively the same view that we saw in a Power BI report, now in an RTI board or a real-time dashboard. What is really, really powerful about this approach to doing dashboarding is that it can actually be a little bit quicker than what you would get with direct query. So you can set this up to be continuous. For example, if I click edit, I go to manage, and I actually change this to be continuous. This will be effectively a real-time dashboard.
Real-time.
And so I've actually, now it's refreshing less than a second, which you cannot do in Power BI direct query mode. And the last really, really interesting thing that it can do that you cannot really do in Power BI is you can have one KQL query that many of the visuals use.
Oh.
Now that's a performance benefit because you only need to hit the database once to pull that query. And you could have 5 to 10 to 15 visuals hitting that one single cached result set. Really good efficiencies for streaming data here. So I mentioned earlier that my daughter, she loves Minecraft. I love Minecraft. So now we don't need to be sitting there to actually monitor our farms. We can have our farms up and running. We can have our fabric blocks inside the game, capturing all that telemetry, and using our phones, we can just monitor the performance of our farmers. Really, really cool technology.
Yes. All right, Simon, I love it. There's great use of Microsoft Fabric. I love video games too. So it's sparking me a little bit and thinking about what else could I do. I guess folks, I'll hand it off to you. Let us know down in the comments below, are you taking advantage of real-time intelligence? What kind of data sources do you want to use with this? Did this inspire you to go do something within your organization? Probably not with Minecraft, but you know, with something like a factory or something going on there. So let us know down in the comments. We would love to hear it. As always, from myself, Patrick, Martha, and
Simon,
thank you for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.